من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Alhamdulillah, we praise Allah and we seek His assistance and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Wherever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray, and whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that no God has the right to be worshipped other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as you ought to be feared and don't die except as Muslims. O humanity, fear your Lord who has created you from a single soul and created from it its mate, has gathered from them too many men and women. And fear Allah for whom you demand your mutual rights, and don't cut off relations with the wombs that bore you. Indeed, Allah is the Raqib over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and say that which is correct, in order that He may accept from you your deeds and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has achieved the greatest achievement. Amma ba'du. Certainly the most truthful speech is the Book of Allah, and the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in this deen, and every newly invented matter in this deen is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is a strang, and every strang is in the fire. Continuing with the aqidah of Abu al-Hassan al-Ashari rahimahullah, and his point that we believe in the authentic narrations of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the Dajjal, we finish up this topic of the Dajjal with the chapter, the things to do to safeguard yourself from the fitna of the Dajjal. And the first point is the hadith of Imam Muslim rahimahullah, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا تَشَهَّدَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ أَرْبَعَ يَقُولُ اللَّهُمَّ إني أعوذ بك من عذاب جهنم ومن عذاب القبر ومن فتنة المحيا والممات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, when one of you makes the tashahud, then I command him to seek refuge in Allah from four things. He says, O Allah, I seek refuge in you from the punishment of Jahannam, and from the punishment of the grave, and from the fitna of life and death, and from the evil of the fitna of Al-Masih Ad-Dajjal. So here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he shows us one of the ways to safeguard ourselves from the fitna of the Dajjal, or to protect ourselves from the fitna of a Dajjal, is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us and to seek refuge in Allah from the evil of the fitna of the Masih al-Dajjal. At the end of our salah, just before we say Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, after you finish your tashahud and you're about to say Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, then you say Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min azabi jahannam wa min azabi al-qabr وَمِنْ فِتْنَةِ الْمَحْيَا وَالْمَمَاتِ وَمِنْ شَرِّ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحَ الدَّجَّالِ. And this is a narration of Imam Muslim. And I remember some time ago when some of the brothers were arguing about this point. Is it compulsory for you to say this in your salah or not? First we see that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam commands us to make this dua before we finish our salah. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He tells us at the end of Surah An-Nur, فَلْيَحْذِرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. And give warning to those who oppose his command, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give warning to those who oppose his command that there may befall him a fitna or a painful chastisement. A fitna meaning in this world and a painful chastisement in the hereafter. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us from disobeying the commandment of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he commands us here. And we know that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَتَعِدَّ حُدُودَهُ يُدَخِلْهُ نَارٌ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَلَهُ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger and transgresses the bounds, we will enter him into the fire abiding therein forever, and this is a humiliating punishment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayat shows us the path of the person who disobeys the commandment of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this shows that when he commands us to do something, then it's compulsory on us to do it. And we take into consideration the hadith of, I think, Imam Muslim or Al-Bukhari and Muslim. That's in the collection of 40 hadith where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ وَإِذَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِأَمْرٍ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if I prohibit you from doing something, then stay away from it. And if I command you to do something, then do it as much as you can. And this is what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. And fear Allah as much as you are able to. And this is the understanding of our Salaf al-Salih as Imam al-Tawus, and he's from the, what you call the Kibar al-Tabi'een, or from the big Tabi'een. And when they say big and small Tabi'een, the bigger ones mean the older ones and the ones who have met more of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as opposed to the younger ones. Who the smaller tabi'een who maybe met one companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or maybe two companions, as opposed to some of the bigger ones like Tawus and Al Hasan Al Basri and Sa'id ibn Musayyib, Muhammad ibn Sirin. They were dying around just after the Sahaba, meaning they were born maybe 40 Hijra, like that, 30 Hijra. You know, shortly after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, they were born. Or some of them, maybe they were born while the Prophet ﷺ was living, but they didn't meet him, alayhi salatu wasalam, and they met his companions, because they lived in a farther land, or what have you. At any rate, Tawus, he used to command his son to make his salat over if he didn't make this dua in his salat. And this shows that he felt that this thing was compulsory, rather fard, to make it in his salat, so much so that he commanded his son to make his salat over if he didn't make that dua in his salat. As far as us and our circumstances where we accepted Islam and we're trying to learn little by little of our salat, inshallah ta'ala, until we learn this dua, we hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts our dua. As we know that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we know that the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he told the man who came to him and said, I can't read anything from the Quran, I can't memorize anything from the Quran. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to say in his salah, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, to the end of that hadith. And we know that this is how a person learns the salat right after shahada, to learn the phrases subhanallah, alhamdulillah, like this, and the basic dua, Allahumma qfirli, warhamni, wa'afini, warzuqni. That he learns this basic dua so that he can join right in the ranks and start to make his salat. And then he starts to learn Surah Al-Fatiha. Then he's going to learn his dua al-istiftah, subhanallah, Allahumma wa bihamdika wa tabaraka smuka, like this, or some of the other du'as, Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khataya ya kama ba'idta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghribi. Then he's going to learn after that another surah from the Quran, and then sami Allahu liman hamida rabbana wa lakal hamd, and the rest of his salah. And you know, as we were learning our salah, we learn a little bit maybe this week or this month, we get this down the next month and like that. And this du'a is important for us, as we saw that our Salaf al-Salih used to understand that you should make your salat over if you don't have this in it. because of it being compulsory. And besides, this is one of the ways to safeguard ourselves and to protect ourselves from the fitna of the Masih al-Dajjal. عن مصعب قال كان سعد يأمر بخمس ويذكرهن عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه كان يأمر بهن اللهم إني أعوذ بك من البخل وأعوذ بك من الجبن وأعوذ بك أن أرد إلى أرض للعمر وأعوذ بك من فتنة الدنيا يعني فتنة الدجال وأعوذ بك من عذاب القبر. And this is the narration of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. Mus'ab rahimahullah, he said that Sa'idun used to command with five things, that the people do these five things. And he mentioned that these five things came from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he used to command the people to do these five things. And this is the statement, O Allah, indeed I seek refuge in you from being stingy, and I seek refuge in you from being a coward, and I seek refuge in you from going back to I seek refuge in you from becoming senile. I think that's what you call it. When you get real old and then you start to act like a baby again. That's what it when you get old, you start going back just like you forget, you act like a baby, you need help, and like that. So we seek refuge in Allah from being like that when we get an old age. And we seek refuge in Allah from the fitna of the dunya, which means the fitna of a dajjal. And I seek refuge in you from the punishment of the grave. So here we see that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we have covered hadith like this when we covered in the purification of the souls, the book Kitab al-Isti'adha, the book of seeking protection or refuge in Allah from Imam al-Nasa'i, and we covered these different hadiths. And here we want to use this point that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put us to seek refuge in Allah from the fitna of the dunya. And Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, in his explanation of Sahih Bukhari, he says that the Prophet taught us to seek refuge in Allah from the dunya. And Shu'bah, as he's one of the narrators in the chain between Imam al-Bukhari and Sa'idun, who narrated this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explained that what was meant by the dunya is the dajjal. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us the wording ad-dunya. And Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar, he explains this by saying that the word dunya is used as if it's referring to the fitna of the whole world, and what's really meant is the dajjal, to show that there's no fitna greater than the dajjal that's going to take place on this world. And this is from the statement of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, la fitnata a'zamu min fitnati ad-dajjal. And this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I'm taking it from my book that I have in front of me, Ashratu Sa'a, from Yusuf al-Wabil, and he's quoting from Al-Fath al-Bari, the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, where he quotes this hadith in the explanation, not that it's from Sahih al-Bukhari, but in the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, he brings other hadiths and other narrations in order to clarify some of the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari. And we hope that this hadith has been authentically reported on the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. As in the beginning of this 12-volume explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, he makes as a condition for himself that any hadith that he mentions, if he doesn't say that it's da'if, that means that it's at least hasan or sahih, meaning that it's authentic so long as he doesn't clarify that it is da'if. And some of the ulama have come behind him on some of these hadith and proven him wrong when he didn't mention the authenticity, to show that it wasn't in fact authentic. And we hope that this has been authentically reported on the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that there is no fitna greater than the fitna of the dajjal. And this hadith that has been authentically reported on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying that we seek refuge in Allah from the fitna of the dunya, what is meant is the dajjal. And this shows the same meaning of this hadith. Walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. So there's no fitna. Walaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. There's no fitna greater than the fitna of the Dajjal, and we have to seek the refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and to seek Allah's protection from the Dajjal, as this is one of the ways to safeguard ourselves from the fitna of the Dajjal. Yes. Al-Masih al-Dajjal. Al-Masih. We had covered in the first class. This is, I think, the third part of the the talk on this point of al-Dajjal. That the Masih, it has two meanings, and both of those meanings are opposites from each other. The Masih means the truth, the trustworthy, and the truthful. As you say, al-Masih Isa ibn Maryam, the truthful, the trustworthy one. And you say al-Masih al-Dajjal, it means the liar, Dajjal. So this word has opposite meanings: the truth, the trust, the truthful, and the liar. And you have to understand it in the context. And this is when it refers to the Dajjal, it's the liar, and when it refers to Isa ibn Maryam, it's the Siddiq sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here we see that this is the biggest fitna, and this is one of the ways to protect ourselves and safeguard ourselves from this fitna of the Dajjal, is by seeking refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from it. And to also just reflect a little bit on this hadith, that sometimes, wallahi, in the marriages, it seems like there's no more fitna bigger than the lady in this dunya. And here the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he shows us that there is a fitna bigger than them, and this is the fitna of the Dajjal. And we need to seek protection from it. And the reason I brought that is because all of us, and being married, we see the fitna of our wives regularly, and we know the seriousness of it, and we hope that knowing this, we will know that it's even more serious, this fitna of the Dajjal. And there are hadith from the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, that says that he didn't leave any fitna bigger on the men than the women. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our women amongst the righteous and make us amongst the patient with them. As-Saffarini rahimahullah, he says, so it's necessary or proper for every person of knowledge to spread these hadith of the Dajjal to the children and the women and the men. And I mentioned this point of the Shaykh, as he shows the importance of spreading the knowledge of these hadith of the Dajjal, because it's very important and there's no fitna bigger than it, and you want to prepare the Muslims for this fitna if it comes, the fitna of the Dajjal. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says in the hadith that's authentic inshaAllah, collected by Abdullah ibn Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal in his let me explain after the hadith inshaAllah ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, لا يخرج الدجال حتى يذهل الناس عن ذكره وحتى تترك الأئمة ذكره على المنابر. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that the Dajjal won't come until the people forget about him and start remembering that he's going to come. So much so until the imams forget to mention that the Dajjal is coming over the minbar. Meaning when the imam is giving the khutbah or addressing the people, that they stop mentioning that the Dajjal is coming and that the fitna of the Dajjal is serious. And prepare yourselves by seeking refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from the Dajjal. And prepare yourself from knowing the description of the Dajjal, so that when he comes, you know him and you know how to get away from him. So here we see in this hadith of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, that's authentic inshaAllah, the seriousness of this issue of the Dajjal and the seriousness of seeking refuge in Allah from the Dajjal and preparing ourselves for the time when the Dajjal comes by knowing his characteristics. And also by preparing the Muslims, by teaching the children, teaching the women, teaching the brothers about this issue of the Dajjal, and that the Dajjal is coming. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his protection. I wanted to explain this point. This is just a little side point about hadith that I think everybody heard, collected by Ahmed. This means the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmed. And he's known as Ahmed ibn Hanbal, who is really Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal, of which they have the Hanbali school. He has his Musnad that's collected in the edition of the Maymuna, 6 volumes. This was the most popular edition of the Musnad of Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah. His son, Abdullah ibn Ahmed, narrated his book of hadith. In those days, and he died 241 Hijra, as the same thing like Bukhari and Muslim, they were the memorizers of the hadith of the Messenger of Allah. They'd have a sitting like we have in our classes. He would narrate the hadith. Bukhari would say, I heard it was reported to me by so-and-so, the son of so-and-so said it was reported to me by the son of so-and-so, said it was reported to me by the son of so-and-so, said that was reported to me by Abu Hurairah that the Prophet said such and such. And the people are listening and memorizing. And the Shaykh is narrating the hadith, and the people are memorizing it as he narrates it. And don't be surprised that the people memorize it right on the spot, as we used to, and we have some people who can memorize songs right on the spot, word for word. He heard a song one time, he got all of the lyrics down. And this is the same case with some of the musicians, that they hear it and they know all of the whatever of it. So these are the minds of the believers who believe in Allah Ta'ala, and that they used to listen to the hadith and they memorize it. And then some of them, as Ibn Abi Hatim, they used to say that we listen to the Shaykh, we memorize the whole dars, then we go back at night and we write from our memorization everything that we memorize, so that if we forgot, we go back to our book to remember. And this is how they used to do it. At any rate, Imam Ahmed narrated his Musnad to his son, Abdullah. His son, Abdullah, rahimahullah, narrated the Musnad to the people. And now that the Musnad comes, and it doesn't start with, Imam Ahmed said it was narrated to us by such and such. Every hadith starts off with, Abdullah said it was narrated to me by my father, who said that it was narrated by, to the end of the chain, back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he narrates it. In some of those hadith, he doesn't say it was narrated to me by my father. He just says it was narrated to me by so and so, said that it was narrated to me by so and so, to the back. And he put it along with those that some of the ulama say, about 40,000 hadith in that collection. And I forgot how many hadith Abdullah has, maybe 300 or something like that, where he doesn't say it was narrated to me by my father. This is one of those hadith where he didn't say it was narrated to me by my father. And this book, this hadith is collected in a book called Majmu' al-Zawa'id. Majmu' al-Zawa'id is a book that collects the hadith from this Musnad of Imam Ahmed, and I think there's 6 other books, that he takes these books and every hadith that these books have that's not in the 6 books of hadith, he puts it in this collection. Meaning he went through the whole Musnad of Imam Ahmed. And in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed, you have hadith that's in Bukhari, the same thing that's in Bukhari, same thing that's in Muslim, same thing that's in Abu Dawood, and like that, as they were all around the same time period, and they were all memorizing the hadith of the Messenger of Allah. He takes these hadith that are not there and put it in this book. So that means if he says it's narrated by Ahmed, then you know that it's not in the collection of the 6 books. And the same thing with Tabarani and the other books that he used. So these books were, this book is a good book, and some of the ulama, they wrote books like this. And these are the books, because the 6 books of hadith are well known. So the other books of hadith, you know, they have the same hadith as the 6 books. But because the 6 books of hadith are more popular, then most of the people leave off those books, and the ulama bought the extra hadith from those books and collected it in books, So you have the six books of hadith, and then you only look at the extra, and this is for the everyday ordinary people like ourselves. Walhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. At any rate, we see the importance of seeking refuge in Allah from the Dajjal. And this is one of the ways to safeguard ourselves from the Dajjal. Another one of the ways to safeguard ourselves from the Dajjal is by reading the opening ayat of Suratul Kahf, chapter, the cave, number 18 of the Quran, where the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says in the hadith of Imam Muslim, غير الدجال أخوفني عليكم أن يخرج وأنا فيكم فأنا حجيجه دونكم وإن يخرج ولست فيكم فامرؤ حجيج نفسه والله خليفتي على كل مسلم إنه شاب قطط عينه طافئة كأني أشبهه بعبد العزى ابن قطن فمن أدركه منكم فليقرأ عليه فواتيح سورة الكهف to the end of this hadith of the Dajjal, where the Messenger of Allah sallam said, I have more fear for you than I have about the fear that I have about the Dajjal. And I was trying to read the explanation of the ulama, and we hope that this is the correct understanding, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is just trying to show that I'm really frightened for you about the Dajjal coming, and how this fitna is so great on you, I'm just afraid that you might be destroyed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what is meant by the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, غَيْرُ الدَّجَّالِ أَخْوَفُنِي عَلَيْكُمْ. And then the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he says, if the Dajjal comes while I'm still living in amongst you, then I'll be your proof against him. I mean, I'll be your proof for you to show, there you go right there, that's the Dajjal, seek refuge in Allah from him, stay away from him, seek protection. And we'll show some of the other ways, like running to Medina, reading these ayat from Surah Al-Kahf. And the Messenger of Allah says, if the Dajjal comes and I'm not amongst you, then every individual will be the proof for his own self. Here the Messenger of Allah says, and now he's died alayhi salatu wasalam, as Allah raised him up to the Rafiq al-A'la, that the Prophet is the one to say, there is the Dajjal right there, seek refuge in Allah from him. But that everybody's going to be his own proof. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he left in the authentic hadith the characteristics of the Dajjal and told us what to do when the Dajjal takes place. When he comes, either you're going to know the deal or you're finished. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us. The Messenger of Allah says, no. Now we're going to deal with that's going to be our last chapter tonight, inshallah. Who's going to kill the Dajjal? وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he says, and Allah is my Khalifa for every Muslim. Imam An-Nawi rahimahullah, he didn't bring any explanation to this point, part of the hadith, and his explanation of Sahih Muslim. I just mentioned just last night that before I translate my hadith or the ayah, I always go back to the explanation, then I bring the explanation as a part of the translation of the hadith. Not that I rely on myself and my knowledge of the Arabic language to make a translation of the ayat and of the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that we study the understanding of the ayat or the hadith from the books of the ulama, and then we bring that across. He didn't say anything. And I remember asking one of our sheikhs, Sheikh, if we don't know, or I say, not that, Sheikh, we read the hadith of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, and we rely on the books of explanation from the scholars of Islam for
for the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some hadith we don't find any explanation for. This was the first part of the question. Like the Musnad of Imam Ahmad that we're just talking about. It doesn't have a book of explanation. The Mustadrak of Al-Hakim, it doesn't have an explanation to it. Sahih Ibn Hibban, it doesn't have an explanation for it. The Ma'ajim of At-Tabarani, they don't have explanations for it. The Musnad of Imam Ya'la, Abu Ya'la, Al-Mawsili, and other books like this, they don't have any explanation for them. How are we going to know what the hadith mean? And those collections of hadith, if they don't have an explanation from the ulama, and we can't sit you down and get the explanation of all these hadith, what are we to do? And then the ulama, alaykum salaam wa rahmatullah, the ulama, alhamdulillah, they said, no, some ulama wrote the explanation of these hadith in other books of hadith, in other books of explanation of the hadith. Like we've heard of the book called Mishkat al-Musabih that alhamdulillah is translated into English. It has a collection of hadith from everywhere. Somebody wrote the explanation, Ali al-Qari, he wrote the explanation to Mishkat al-Musabih. So in some of those hadith from like al-Bayhaqi, the Sunan al-Kubra al-Bayhaqi, or maybe his book of the Sha'ab al-Iman from al-Bayhaqi, and those other books, Sahih ibn Hibban, Musnad Imam Ahmad, you get the explanation of some of those hadith as they come in the Mishkat collection. Also the same thing from a book called Fable Qadir al-Manawi. This book is the explanation of the book called Al-Jam al-Saghir, which isn't translated into English. It's by Imam al-Suyuti, where he used about 40 different collections of hadith, and he put it into alphabetical order from the first word of the hadith. I'll try to get a first word of the hadith. Like, you know the hadith that all begin, La yu'minu ahadukum. None of you truly believes until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. None of you truly believes until he makes me more beloved to him. Every hadith, none of you. Alright, and he just makes it in order. Like he put it in chapter in. None of you, none. So he puts all of the first words of the hadith in alphabetical order. And if you do it from Arabic, you have the first thing is the hadith with from Aleph, then Ba, then Ta, then the hadith that begin with Lata, and like that all the way down to Ya at the end. So he has this book, and he has this from about 40 something books, and Al-Manawi wrote an explanation for this. So if you find a hadith from Musnad Imam Ahmad and you don't find the explanation for it, then the first thing comes to your mind, let me see if this hadith in Mishkat, let me see if this hadith is in Al-Jam al-Saghir. Then maybe you might see, is this a fifth issue? If it is, maybe it might be in Nail al-Awta. This is the explanation of hadith on fiqh issue. Or like we have the book Al-Bulugh al-Maram. Now it's translated into English on fiqh issues by Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar. This Bulugh al-Maram, it has hadith that aren't in the six books of hadith. That was explained by As-San'ani, Al-Amir Ismail As-San'ani, who wrote Subul al-Salam, which is the explanation for that. So at any rate, the Shaykh told us you can go to these books to find the explanation of hadith that don't have explanations written for that collection of hadith. Then we say, Shaykh, what about the explanation of hadiths that have been explained already that don't explain a particular part of the hadith that we don't understand? Then the Shaykh said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. If you find yourselves in that case, then take the statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on its most apparent meaning. If they didn't explain anything, that means then it's well known that it means just what it says, and there's nothing behind it other than what you hear. And we hope that this is the case on this statement, Wallahu khalifati ala kulli Muslim, and Allah is my khalifa on every Muslim. And the khalifa is the one that comes after you to handle the affairs that you handle. And when the Messenger of Allah ﷺ began, if I'm amongst you when the Dajjal comes, then I'm going to be your proof for you that the Dajjal is so and so. And when I'm gone, then a person is going to be a proof for himself, and Allah is my Khalifa after me. I mean, hopefully Allah will make it clear to the believers who the Dajjal is, so that everyone will be on certainty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best on the meaning of the statement of the Messenger of Allah, Wallahu khalifati ala kulli muslim. As I was giving the straight Arabic meaning from the Arabic words without any other explanation, Allah knows best. The Prophet ﷺ describes the Dajjal. Indeed, he is a young man with knotty hair and an eye with meat over top of it. And it's like, or I would compare him to look like the brother named Abdul Uzza ibn Qatan. And this was somebody there that everybody knew. The Prophet ﷺ said he looks like him. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever meets him, then read the opening ayat from Suratul Kahf, from the chapter of the cave. So here the Messenger of Allah, he shows us when the Dajjal comes to read the beginning ayat from Suratul Kahf as a protection from the Dajjal. And also just this past week, unfortunately, I heard it again that some of the brothers, they still say that the Dajjal is like the American government or Zionism or the New World Order or whatever they try to say that the Dajjal is. And the Messenger of Allah had already described him as being a man and gave his characteristics and everything. And the Messenger of Allah, the people who have any doubt left said, and he looks like that man right there, Abdul Uzza ibn Qatan. So how can somebody say that the Dajjal is some abstract, mysterious, plotting government or world order or something, after the Messenger of Allah ﷺ made this deen clear to us? This is burdening oneself beyond that which is necessary. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Prophet ﷺ says in the other narration of Imam Muslim, من حفظ عشر آيات من أول سورة الكهف عصم من الدجال أي من فتنته. Prophet ﷺ says, whoever memorizes 10 ayat from the beginning of Suratul Kahf, then he will be protected from the Dajjal, meaning protected from the fitna of the Dajjal. And Imam Muslim rahimahullah, he says that Shu'ba, one of the narrators of the hadith, says from the last, min akhir al-kahfi, 10 ayats from the last ayat of Suratul Kahf. And Hammam, he says from the first ayat of Suratul Kahf. And this is as you have in some of the narrations of hadith where it might come this and that. And we hope that the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam said one time the beginning of Suratul Kahf as Hammam had memorized, and hopefully he says sallallahu alayhi wasalam the last ayat of Suratul Kahf as Shu'ba said rahimahullah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We just read these ayat, inshallah ta'ala. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala 'abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu 'iwaja. قَيِّمًا لِيُنْذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا مَاكِثِينَ فِيهِ أَبَدًا وَيُنْذِرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبَلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا.
I just see Master Khan's translation, inshallah. Those are the first ayat, 10 ayat from Surah Al-Kahf. And Master Khan, he translates these ayat.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All praise and thanks be to Allah who has sent down to His slave, referring to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the book, referring to the Quran, and has not placed therein any crookedness. He has made it straight to give warning to the disbelievers of a severe punishment from Him, and to give glad tidings to the believers in the oneness of Allah, Islamic monotheism, who worked righteous deeds, that they shall have a fair reward, i.e. paradise. They shall abide therein forever. And to warn those Jews, Christians, and pagans who say Allah has begotten a son or offspring or children. No knowledge have they of such a thing, nor had their fathers. Mighty is the word that comes out of their mouths, i.e. He begot or took sons and daughters. They utter nothing but a lie. Perhaps you would kill yourself, talking to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, perhaps you would kill yourself in grief over their footsteps, for their turning away from you, because they believe not in this narration, the Quran. And this Arabic word is al-hadith. And this is why we say we're the people of hadith, ahlul hadith, that it doesn't mean that you follow the hadith and not the Quran. But hadith is a word that refers to the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, as we see in this ayat right here in Surah Al-Kahf. Verily, we have made that which is on earth as an adoration for it, in order that we may test them, mankind, as to which of them are best in deeds. And then Marsim Khani explains, i.e., those who do good deeds in the most perfect manner, that means to do them the deeds totally for Allah's sake and in accordance to the legal ways of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Allah continues as we translate, and verily, we shall make all that is on it, on the earth, a bare, dry soil, meaning without any vegetation or trees, etc. Do you think that the people of the cave and the inspiration, the news or the names of the people of the cave, were a wonder among our signs? Remember when the young men fled for refuge for their from their disbelieving folk to the cave, they said, "Our Lord, bestow on us mercy from yourself and facilitate for us our affair in the right way." These are the first 10 ayat from Surah Al-Kahf. And then the last 10 ayat from Surah Al-Kahf and I'm going to start with the last 9 ayat, as Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, he explains what's meant by the last 10 ayat is these last 9 ayat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And this starts from this ayah 102. أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَن يَتَّخِذُوا عِبَادِي مِن دُونِي أَوْلِيَاءَ إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا جَهَنَّمَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ نُزُلًا قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا أولئك الذين كفروا بآيات ربهم ولقائه فحبطت أعمالهم فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا ذلك جزاؤهم جهنم بما كفروا واتخذوا آياتي ورسلي هزوا إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. And these last ayat, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, as Muhsin Khan translates from ayat 102, Do then those who disbelieve think that they can take my slaves, i.e. the angels, Allah's messengers, Jesus the son of Mary, etc., as awliya, meaning as lords, gods, or protectors, etc., besides me? Verily we have prepared entertainment for the disbelievers, meaning in the oneness of Allah, the Islamic monotheism. And then the Muhsin Khani brings a hadith related to this, and the people can refer to that inshallah ta'ala. And Allah continues as he translates, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, shall we tell you the greatest losers in respect of their deeds, those whose efforts have been wasted in this life while they thought that they were acquiring good by their deeds. They are those who deny the ayat, meaning the proofs, evidences, verses, lessons, signs, revelations, etc., of their Lord and the meeting with him in the hereafter. So their works are in vain, and on the day of resurrection we shall not give them any weight. That shall be their recompense, hell, because they disbelieve and took my ayat and my messengers by way of jest and mockery. Verily those who believe and do righteous deeds shall have the gardens of Al-Firdaus for their entertainment, wherein they shall dwell forever. No desire will they have to be removed therefrom. Say, and this is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if the sea were ink for writing the words of my Lord, surely the sea would be exhausted before the words of my Lord will be finished, even if we brought another sea like it for its ink. Say, I am only a man like you. It has been inspired to me that your Ilah, your God, is one God. So whoever hopes for the meeting with his Lord, let him work righteousness and associate none as a partner in the worship of his Lord. So these are the ayat that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches us to recite to save ourselves or to protect ourselves from the Dajjal. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, and this is the last hadith inshallah, man sami'a bid-dajjali falyan'a anhu fa wallahi innar rajula la ya'tihi wa huwa yahsibu annahu mu'minun fayatba'uhu mimma yub'athu bihi min ash-shubuhati aw lima yub'athu bihi min ash-shubuhati. And this is collected by Al-Hakim, and Al-Hakim is one of the books that doesn't have an explanation for it, but it's mentioned in Sahih or Al-Jami al-Saghir, which has the explanation. And it means, inshallah, where the Prophet says, whoever hears that of the Dajjal, meaning whoever hears that the Dajjal is here on the earth, he has come, then stay far away from him. When you hear it, stay far away from him. And here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us how to safeguard ourselves from it. You hear that the Dajjal is in Newark, New Jersey, move to New York. Or if you hear he's in California, move to Alaska.
or something like that, as the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, when you hear of him, stay far away from him. And I swear by Allah that indeed a man, the Dajjal would come to him, and the man would think that the Dajjal is a believer, and he will follow the Dajjal because of what the Dajjal has of Shubuhat. Shubuhat, and Allah knows best, this is the thing that the liar has with him to make you think that what he has is the truth. He dazzles you or amazes you, or he does something that nobody else can do, or something like that to make you think that there's something special about him. And he's the Dajjal, and then he tricks you or deceives you, and then he leads you astray, and you follow him right into the hellfire. And the ulama had given some examples, like he uses magic, as we had heard it had taken place when the Muslims were trying to practice the Sunnah way back in America, and what was called the Dar movement. The Muslims, they were trying to practice the Sunnah and establish the Salat in the Masjid and dress like Muslims and learn and read the Hadith of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. So I met quite a few brothers who were from this Dar movement, and then Jilani came. And Jilani came and he was talking to the brothers of the Dar movement, and then he was just like looking. The brothers had narrated the story to me. Allah knows best with authenticity. But Jilani came and he broke them up, and they said he was talking and he was looking in the faces of the people, and he said, "You don't believe me. You don't believe me, do you?" He dug in his chest and he pulled his heart out. "Tell me this heart ain't speaking the truth." And they said like blood was just dripping from his hand, and his heart was just like right in his hand. And he said, "Look at it. Tell me I ain't telling you the truth. Tell me this heart ain't sincere. Tell me this ain't for real. Tell him the truth. You don't believe me?" Then he just put it back in his chest. And some of the people believed him because they were amazed. And then they said after that, or in another one of the sessions, he just started floating as he was giving the talk. And then he just started rising up. And he's still talking, and he's just talking to the brother, and then he comes down. And then the people are amazed, and he says something like, "Whatever, you know, I have more, there's more where this comes from," or whatever. At any rate, and they have something that will amaze, that the people will be amazed by, and then they use that to attract you to him. And the Dajjal will do this for those people who aren't strong. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in iman, and to give us the knowledge of these characteristics of the Dajjal, so that we can know him. And the Messenger of Allah said, every believer would be able to know that he's the Dajjal, because he's going to have Kafir written on him. And this is the Muslims who know how to read, and the Muslims who, the believers who know how to read, and the believers who don't know how to read. The Messenger of Allah said, they will be able to tell that's the Dajjal. And this is because of their iman and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we hope that this is the understanding of that hadith of Sahih Muslim, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah is my khalifa for every Muslim, that Allah is going to give the real believers that criterion that they need to tell that that person is the Dajjal himself, and that they would be able to stay away from him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And we can just summarize this point of the Dajjal, that it's real, he's real, he, a person, he's real, and he's coming, and he comes in the latter days, and when he's not mentioned that much, and the people aren't aware, as the Messenger of Allah showed us in some of these hadith, and the Prophet gave us, inshallah, that which is sufficient for us to protect ourselves and to safeguard ourselves from the Dajjal by seeking refuge in Allah, from the Dajjal by staying far away from the Dajjal. And as we had mentioned earlier, that the Dajjal can't enter Mecca and Al-Madinah. So if you hear the Dajjal is coming, get on the plane and hurry to Mecca and Medina to safeguard yourself against the Dajjal. And I remember some of the people, they were saying that in Mecca and Medina, they don't let you in anymore, because now it's not just Arabia, it's Saudi Arabia. And if they let you in, then you come, and if they don't, you don't. And If the Dajjal comes, you can believe that planes will be flying from everywhere. And how they're going to stop the people when the people start coming, as the issue of the Dajjal is serious. When the people just come, what are they going to do? Shoot down all the planes? Especially when Arabia only had an army of 60,000 men. And how they're going to handle all of the planes that come in to Arabia. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But we have to rely on Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and not to be frightened by what we see in this world, and to seek refuge in Allah from having men to be in control over us, and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control of this world, and whatever He decrees will take place will. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the fitna of the Dajjal. I don't know if there were any questions left around the Dajjal. What will the shaitan do? I don't know the relationship between the shaitan and the Dajjal, except that what we know from these hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I don't know if there were any other questions. If not, then let's go back to the brother's original question. Can we just kill him? I mean, now we're in the days, mashallah, of some fine weaponry, even for the regular person, we can buy something nice, mashallah, to put right between the eyes of Kafara or the Dajjal. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he shows us. All right, wanted to say this point for the last point. Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he shows us who's going to kill the Dajjal. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, general narration. And anyway, we'll just quote the narration, inshallah, of Sahih Muslim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يَخْرُجُ الدَّجَّالُ فِي أُمَّتِي. And then he mentioned the hadith, and part of the hadith it has, فَيَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ كَأَنَّهُ عُرْوَةَ بْنَ مَسْعُودٍ فَيَطْلُبُهُ فَيَهْلِكُهُ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this hadith, and I encourage the brothers to try to read some of the translations of these hadith of the Dajjal and al-Bukhari and Muslim, because they're real long hadith. And it might be a class in itself just to read the whole hadith in Arabic and the translation. And those hadith are real long hadith. And we've been just taking part of the hadith in order to bring this issue closer to us. Allah knows best. And this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, the Dajjal will come in my ummah. And Allah would send Isa ibn Maryam, and he would be like Urwa ibn Mas'ud. And here the Prophet ﷺ is showing what Isa looks like, and this is the companion Urwa ibn Mas'ud. So he's going to search out and find the Dajjal and then destroy him. So the Messenger of Allah ﷺ shows us that Isa ibn Maryam is going to be the one, as we see in the hadith of Tirmidhi and others, where the Prophet ﷺ says, يَقْتُلُ بُنُ مَرْيَمَ الدَّجَّالَ بِبَابِ لُدْ. That Ibn Maryam will kill the Dajjal at the area of Lud. And the area of Lud, I forgot where that's at. I think that's Sham, or just north of Medina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Or that's in Sham, outside of the Arabian Peninsula. Just keeps my mind. Anybody knows where that Lud is? Babu Lud. At any rate, these are the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that shows us that Isa ibn Maryam is going to kill the Dajjal, and Allah subhanahu
وتعالى نبس صلى الله وسلم وبارك الليل على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. If North Carolina, if they had any questions or comments on the Dajjal, this is our last class on the Dajjal. Our next point, inshallah, is our belief in Munkar and Nakir. Munkar and Nakir are those angels that ask the people in the grave. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his protection. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.